Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whosoever Allah leads astray, none can show him guidance. My dear brothers and sisters, may Allah bless this gathering. May Allah shower us with His mercy. Pardon us and forgive us all our sins, and may He keep us all steadfast on the straight path until we meet Him in the best condition of Iman. Ameen. Once upon a time in the life of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the great companion Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu met with another great companion who was one of the scribers of the revelation, Hanzala al-Usaydi. May Allah be pleased with all of them. And he asked, "How are you, Hanzala? How are you doing?" He said, "Ya Abu Bakr, just leave me alone." He said, "What is wrong?" He said, "I feel myself being a hypocrite." Nafaqa Hanzala. He said, "What makes you think that you're a hypocrite? You're one of the scribes of the wahy." He said, "Ya Hanzala, Ya Abu Bakr, so long as we're sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid, he reminds us, he teaches us, whenever he makes mention of Jannah and Naar, it's like we can visualize them. We want to do every possible thing to go to Jannah, and want to stay away from anything that can take us to hellfire. So we enjoy the highest level of Iman while we're sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid." He said, "So then what?" But I don't feel my Iman the same, like whenever I'm sitting in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I'm listening to his preaching." Abu Bakr al-Siddiq said, "That's a serious problem. I have the same problem. Let's go to the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him." He took him from his hand and he went to the Messenger of Allah, and they both shared with him, "Why do you think that there is a problem?" So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Hanzala, by Allah, if you guys maintain the same condition of Iman as you're sitting with me, then in this case, angels would descend from heaven and they would just start shaking hands with you while you are in the streets and while lying down on your beds. Because simply you'll be as pure, as good as angels, but you're not angels. Ya Hanbala, sa'atun wa sa'a. The mainstream of Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah believe that Iman does not stand at a certain level and stop there. Rather, Iman increases and decreases. And accordingly, it keeps fluctuating. We all sometimes feel our Iman is very high. We want to do every possible thing to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When do you normally feel that? After a good khutbah? In Ramadan, whenever you fast and you lower your gaze, whenever you've given in a charity, if you're reading your sabaq and made khatm al-Qur'an, you feel like you're having wings and you're flying in heaven. And when do you feel your iman is very low? After watching a movie. After committing a sin. After looking at what Allah has forbidden you from looking at. After disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that causes one's iman to decrease. But the Almighty Allah is the most merciful. He did not leave us alone without any help. You find in the Quran the guidance as how to maintain, rather also increase the level of iman and maintain steadfastness on the straight path. Because guidance is not for granted. Don't you think that because you're born to Muslim parents, mashallah, you're gonna make it straight to heaven? Don't you think because your name is Muhammad or Abu Bakr or Amanullah that you have already a seat in heaven? Some of the companions left Islam. Can you imagine that? Iman is not for granted. How would a companion abandon Islam? Because steadfastness requires mujahada. Iman and guidance is a gift. But now you need to take care of it. You need to irrigate it. You need to maintain it. You need to constantly maintain it. And in case that you slip right or left on any of the sides of the right path, get back on the track. The Quran taught us what to do in order to catch up and get back on track, not to be left behind. And that's why, brothers and sisters, who should be more concerned about the means of steadfastness than steadfastness itself. Because currently, alhamdulillah, min al-nashid. I don't know what is going to happen to me tomorrow. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's the greatest of all the creatures of Allah. He's al-hadi, the guide, and he's the most guided one ever. He used to ask Allah for hidayah and tasbeet. And keeping him steadfast on the straight path. And he was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what do you think of our own selves? Especially at this time and age where the trials, the fitan of both the doubtful matters and the misconceptions and the fitan of shahawat, the lustful desires, are surrounding us right and left. They chase us even to our bedroom with those smart devices. We definitely need to learn and be acquainted with the means of steadfastness more than anybody else have preceded us. And what worked in the past will continue to work until the day of judgment. Number one and the foremost is the Quran. The Quran, قال عز من قائل في سورة الفرقان وقال الذين كفروا لولا أنزل عليه القرآن جملة واحدة كذلك لنثبت به فؤادك ورتلناه ترتيلا. The kuffar were criticizing the Quran as it wasn't revealed like one chunk, one book, all at once, like the Torah, like the Gospel. How come the Quran keeps being revealing, once upon a time, verses by verses. Is it health? Is it by memorizing the Quran? No, by memorizing the Quran alone, no. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ, and it was their language, and they perfectly comprehended its meaning, but they would take 10 ayat at a time. Umar al-Khattab would have memorized the whole Quran in a couple months, but it took him 8 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. He would memorize until he understands, then implements, then he practices, he digests. So the Quran becomes in his heart and in his practices, in his entire life. He's moving around like Quran. So me memorizing the Quran, as many people assume, if I name my son or daughter Hafiz, khalas, that's it, mashallah, I will have the crown on the day of judgment. And but the reality is the following. Of course, memorizing the Quran is one of the most virtuous acts. So why don't you add to it understanding its meaning? Huh? Or simply you are adding to the library another MP4 recorder. Memorize and compile the entire Quran. Understand it. And also, most importantly, act upon what the Quran says. Some people lose their faith and deen because they don't understand and comprehend the reality of life. Once they are tested with a calamity, if it is a little severe, they turn away from Allah. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ كَانَ يَرْؤُسًا. Whenever evil touches him, he despairs. But when you read the Quran and you scrutinize its verses, and you come across Surah Al-Sharh, in which Allah says, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. And you really comprehend it, then you understand. It's a test, and it will be followed by a relief. Allah will deliver ease. He promised. With every hardship, it must be followed with ease. It's a test in order to remove some of my sins. It's a test in order to raise me into her ranks. So the test should increase the level of your iman, not decrease it. Not take it out of your faith. So, a person who starts his day without reciting Quran and without comprehending at least a few verses, how would he expect this person to maintain iman? While Allah Almighty says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. This is the love of Allah. One of its end is with Allah, and the other end is stretched out. Stretched down for all of us. Hold fast to it. Prior to the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, I'm leaving for you two things. So even if I'm gone, you don't need me, because you already got the means of steadfastness and guidance, the Quran and his sunnah, his traditions and his teachings. And you can never benefit of one without the other. They help and complement each other. Then also another very important means of steadfastness, which goes in line with the natural physics, is competing in respect of doing good deeds. Because in natural physics, there is nothing called empty. There is no such a thing called emptiness. And that's why the ulama say, an-nafs, one's self, one's heart, one's inner desire. If you don't keep it busy with what is good, it will keep you busy with what is evil. When you see a glass of water, full of water, you describe it as full. When you drink half of it, you still describe it as full. I only see half of it. Yes, half of it in physics, in natural physics. Half of it is water, or two-thirds, or one-third. And whatever is left, is then filled with air. So if your heart is not filled with iman, it is filled with its opposite. If the heart is not saturated with the love and the obedience of Allah, then any empty little space isn't empty. It is occupied with an evil desire, with a shahwa, or with a shubha. And it is العمل الصالح. Keep yourself busy. وفي ذلك فليتنافس المتنافسون. Allah repeatedly in the Quran spoke about competition in respect of doing good deeds. Spoke about مصارعة ريس. In Surah Al Imran, it says, وسارعوا وجنة عرضها السماوات والأرض. Don't just walk, no, compete. Race. In Surah from cover to cover. I bet you if you find a single verse in the Quran in which Allah promises the reward, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, and that's it. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ سَيَجْعَلُ لَهُمُ الرَّحْمَنُ وُدًّا. إِنَّ كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ. إن الإنسان لفي خسر.